Hello, I'm Alan Livsey with the Lex column from the Financial Times. I'm here at the 8th Annual World Funds Congress, and I'm with Dame Helena Morrissey. We've just come from the ESG and diversity panel. The question really was about, is diversity the new ESG? But really, we wanted to say...
We wandered off that, didn't we?
I think, because...
I think it's a richer subject. It's not just another sort of letter to add on to a specialist area. I think it is something that's very important for how companies develop their whole talent. It's not just about the governance and how many women there are on the boards, but actually, as we got on to in the panel, more broadly about where we're getting that talent from, how we're developing talent, and how we preserve diversity. Don't just make people copy those who are in more senior roles at the companies.
And you made a strong point when I said, well, there's a fiduciary angle versus the ESG. And you said, well, that's kind of an old, tired argument.
I believe it's one and the same now, that actually to carry out your fiduciary responsibilities, you need to pay attention to diversity as well as environmental, social and governance issues. I think there is an old-fashioned view that actually this was a non-financial measure, didn't have any bearing on sustainable returns, whereas actually now I think it would be very odd to invest in a company that wasn't forward-looking in these areas and would give you pause over its long-term financial future. Mm.
And one other thing we talked about is keeping, sustaining the diversity, if I can use that kind of new quippy phrase there. How do we do that? We get people in. How do we keep them and give them support all the way through? Not just women, but everyone.
Well, I think, we talked a little bit about some of the programs that can be put in place. Elizabeth Corley talked about returnships and so forth. And I'm a very great fan of mentoring to make sure people aren't just left on their own and then encounter a difficulty and don't have anyone to talk to about it. But I do think this is a broader issue about culture at firms. If you have a really inclusive culture, then you shouldn't be having to have special programs. It's just for the moment and perhaps for the foreseeable future. We do have to keep an extra eye, I think, on people that we have deliberately gone out and attracted and because they're different, to make sure then they don't flounder and they're not left out of things.
Yeah. And so it's not just culture at firms, but now do you think we've passed the point now where the final investor, the culture has properly now changed? Or do you think it's more to do with legislation driving things forward and forcing change?
Well, I think we have seen a real wake up around the issue, a sort of second wave, as it were, of enthusiasm about doing something on gender because of the gender pay gap data. I'm not a particular fan of legislation to make people do things, but I have noticed that actually what we've seen in, for example, in the investment industry, which actually has the widest gender pay gap of any sector, I'm afraid, that actually people are really now determined to do something about it, even if it's just to avoid the embarrassment, but also because I suppose perhaps they didn't really realize how far away they were from the norm now, that actually other sectors have done a lot about this issue in recent years, and the fund management industry doesn't really have the mandate to go around telling other companies what to do
until
unless
they clean
we look
up
pretty
house.
Good ourselves.
Okay, Dame Helena, thank you very much for speaking with me.
Thank you, Alan.